My name's Jackson Hinkle. I'm an organizer, I'm an environmentalist. I'm actually the youth director at Choose, and I'm 19 years old and I'm running for San Clemente City Council. I think right now the world is like very split. You know, you have people who just want the best for themselves and their families. You have people who are being oppressed, whether it's by class or race or whatever it may be. And everyone just wants the best and they're looking for that and they're desperate. And that's why you see people going to such extremes politically, economically, whatever it may be. And I really think that now more than ever before, it's important to be truthful, honest, transparent, and accountable. When I was in Washington, D.C. a few months ago, and I was meeting with the energy policy advisor for Senator Kamala Harris of California, we were discussing, you know, energy policy, environmental policy, and things of that nature. And I asked him, you know, like, well, why aren't we pushing for X, Y, and Z right now? And he said, well, you have to understand the nature of American politics right now. We have to be on the defensive. And it was, you know, my understanding going into it that this meeting was specifically set up to be on the offensive, to start taking action in times of injustice and really, you know, change the way that American politics are operating right now. We can't afford to be on the defensive any longer than we currently have been, you know? If we wait another 2, 4, 6 years to be on the, wait to be on the offensive, you know, the nails are already going to be in our coffin. So
a lot of people voted for Donald Trump in 2016 because they wanted to give him a chance. So let's see how he did. For starters, he filled his administration with all the same Wall Street and Goldman Sachs lackeys that he said he was going to drain the swamp of, the same people that made up the Obama and Bush administrations. He said he was going to get us out of the wars, but he didn't even come close to doing that. And in fact, he almost launched us into a new war with Iran. He cut taxes, but really only for his wealthy, rich friends. He renegotiated NAFTA and created the USMCA trade deal in replace of it, but it continued to outsource American jobs and was essentially NAFTA 2.0 on steroids. He didn't build his wall, and he definitely didn't have Mexico pay for it. And oh yeah, he completely mismanaged the coronavirus pandemic, which has resulted in already over 160,000 American deaths. In short, we gave him a chance, and now it's time to get him the fuck out of office.
A few moments later,
said, I do everything for the clout. Nice. You will never see me do something not for the clout. That's the only way I operate.
Whatever the deal is with Nick, there's definitely factions of MPP leaving over convoy. VAMPP is calling supporters white supremacists, conspiracy theorists, anti-vaxxers.
And the party is better off without them. If they want the Movement for a People's Party to be some liberal social circle of like progressive dipshits that went to Ivy League schools and adhered to woke identitarian politics and want to cancel people, by all means, leave the party. That's not what it is. This is a populist party about uniting the left and the right, and that's what it's going to accomplish. And anyone who wants to turn it into something else can go fuck themselves right over back into the Democratic Party. What?
We have crossed the line, Tucker, and it's so interesting that, you know, anyone in the media today would be saying that they liked what Joe Biden said in that speech because it was a dictator-inspired speech. Not only that, but it seems like a lot of the practices and the actions that the Biden administration is employing in the United States right now that were reflected in that speech are very closely aligned with what the dictator Zelensky is doing in Ukraine. Joe Biden is plunging us into a fascist state, and he is taking cues from what Zelensky is doing in Ukraine to manufacture this dystopian state and this dystopian reality in America. And there's no real surprise for me there, because at the end of the day, Volodymyr Zelensky, the president of Ukraine, and Joe Biden are controlled by the same exact people. They're controlled by individuals like George Soros and controlled by people like Klaus Schwab at the World Economic Forum. And they're going to do whatever they want. You know, to put it quite simply, Zelensky is using the intelligence community in Ukraine and the Nazi Azov thugs in Ukraine to silence freedom-loving Ukrainians. Joe Biden in the United States, though he can't remember what he had for breakfast this morning or who his wife is, his handlers and his cronies are prepping the CIA, the FBI, Antifa, the IRS, and now Ministry of Truth to attack freedom-loving Americans. You'd think that they'd do that, but so many of these individuals in Washington, D.C., the neoconservatives, the rhinos, and the entire Democratic Party are beholden to the military-industrial complex. And that is extremely out of line with what average Americans need right now. We don't have clean drinking water in Jackson, Mississippi, yet we're sending $7 billion over to Ukraine, a country that I'm sure most of these Congress people couldn't even point to on a map. It's insane. The White House this week, Tucker, I'm sure you saw, came out and said that anyone who doesn't hold an opinion reflected by the majority of the American public is extreme and therefore an extremist. Well, what does that make Joe Biden? Only 38% of Americans, if you believe the polls and what they tell us, if you believe they're that high, only 38% of Americans agree with Joe Biden. So by the White House's own definition, that makes him an extremist.
When did I ever say Russia would never invade Ukraine? And Russia's not going to invade Ukraine. We haven't been incorrect about anything we've said surrounding Russia and Ukraine this entire time. We have not been incorrect. Russia does not want to invade Ukraine. Russia's not going to invade Ukraine. I never said that that's not going to happen. This Ukraine says they're not going to invade. Russia says they're not going to invade. It's the State Department conspiracy theory. We never said that there was never going to be an invasion. And anyone who says that is just, again, lying. Germany and France have spoken out against these lies that Russia is going to invade Ukraine. But what I'm saying is, I never said that that's not going to happen. Claiming that Russia is going to invade, that's not going to happen. We haven't been incorrect, and we've given more historical context and analysis than anyone else covering this subject, so I'm proud of that. This tweet says, Russia, we aren't going to invade Ukraine. Ukraine, Russia isn't going to invade. The media, they say war is imminent in Ukraine, war is imminent, arm Ukraine, and get them fighting. So, yes, this is a base take. Yes, we should give credit where credit is due. Yes, we should not shit on Candace Owens for having a good take. This is factually correct. We never said that there was never going to be an invasion.
You know, communists today in America don't support the eradication of, say, private property or anything like that. What we support is more growth, more wealth, more businesses for the people, you know, until we reach a point where we have, you know, economic prosperity for all. So, you know, again, the word communism has been so muddied by liberals today and by people like George Soros.
Said, I do everything for the clout. Nice. You will never see me do something not for the clout. That's the only way I operate.